All right, thank you for staying with Daybreak. Let me introduce my guest one more time. Omboko Milembe is here as a chairperson for KUPET, Kennedy Chesa, lecturer and education expert. He's here with us as well. Janet Mudhoni Ouko, CEC Education, Nairobi County, is here with us as well. And Mudheu Kasanga, chairperson, Kenya Private Schools Association. We're talking about unrest in schools. What really is causing the unrest in schools? At Trevor Mbiji at Citizen TV Kenya, use the hashtag Daybreak. And Chesa, I'll start with you here now. So half-term breaks have been reintroduced. Is this a solution to the unrest in schools? What is causing unrest in schools?
The announcement by the ministry that students are going to proceed for half-term next week on Friday is a knee-jerk reaction. It's not going to solve anything, in my opinion. In any event, how do you start a half-term on Friday and end it on a Sunday evening? Day schools, for instance, are always home from Friday to Sunday. So there's a perception that perhaps students in the boarding schools are overstretched and are fatigued and therefore should be sent home. What is causing unrest? Though unrests are popular in second terms, but this is a unique timing because of the stretched calendar. The academic calendar has been stretched. Teachers and students are covering what we used to cover in 15 weeks just within 10 weeks. The midterm breaks have been done away with, and the holiday. The holidays are now very short. Like the December holiday, students will be home for only 7 days. We do not have co-curricular activities in schools. We don't have sports. We don't have music. We don't have drama. And we are dealing with adolescents who have a lot of energy. If you don't contain this energy, you can only come out and get a backlash. When we went back to schools from the COVID, after the COVID-19 pandemic, we did not have a clear administrative guideline on how we are going to contain learners who are fatigued, learners who've been away for over 9 months, and in my opinion, we hurried in coming back. Our idea was, if we had stopped going to school in March 2020, it was only proper to come back in March 2021 and pick from where we had left without disrupting an academic calendar. Why are we in a rush? Why are we having a crash program? Where do we want to take these students that we are rushing? We must complete, I'm told now, teachers have been told to complete from 3 syllabus in the next 3 weeks, because next year, technically, we have two candidate classes, a candidate class in March, a candidate class in December. Why all this rush?
Yeah. Janet, what do you think? Is that the reason why there's unrest in schools? Are you overburdening these students?
Trevor, this is not the first time we are experiencing the kinds of unrest we are seeing.
Yeah.
And in any case, the unrest we are seeing now is not in the magnitude that we have even seen in the past. So for me, much as there is this thing about everyone feeling pressure, that the students are feeling burdened and all that, this is a problem that we probably need to sit down and discuss further and really look at the underlying issues. And for me, when I look at the underlying issues, I am thinking about how we want to come out of this whole thing of boarding schools, you know, as a country. Because we have, you know, agonized that in the past that Kenya is one of the most burdenized, you know, if there's such a word, states in Africa. There is no country that has got the percentages of boarding in secondary school in Africa like ourselves. So there is something that we need to think about, and especially if we want to think about and the audit that I saw,
yeah,
about the Ministry of Education.
We will get into that shortly.
And you know, just thinking about what is the situation of the children. Do you want to tell me that a school that was meant for 100 from once, for example, and now taking 300, for example, we are not going to have any other underlying issues? And you know, some questions also. Why aren't private schools,
yeah,
going into flames? They are going through the same COVID. They are going through the same pressures. Why are we not seeing this trend in private schools? And again, why are we not seeing this trend in the Alliance, Mangus? Why are we not seeing that trend in those kinds of schools? So there are so many other underlying issues with a lot of these small schools and probably middle,
yeah,
and it has a lot to do with the management. And the management is not an indictment on the part of the principal.
Yeah.
We all know that a lot of our schools are cash strapped, so that the conditions how you want to address the grievances of the learners, because sometimes it's just about a bad meal, you know. Sometimes it's just about a bad meal. Sometimes it's a worker who has not been paid for 3 months because the workers are there in the school, and so they're not facilitating the smooth flow of information as would be expected. So I think for me the debate is broader,
yeah,
and it's more about how we want the sector to go and where we want the sector to go. We had this same problem in, I think, 2017.
Yeah.
I think over 100 schools went up in flames in 2017.
Yeah.
Yet we did not develop ourselves into a solution. So that this one now, and I agree when the minister says let's break a little, because it will not help if one more school and another school goes up in flames, okay, and especially because if the learners are saying we need a break.
Okay.
It is goodwill that has been shown that yes, we want to listen to you. As our children, we are listening to you. You have said you want a meter break.
Yeah.
Please have it. And let's go have this conversation with your parents and let us know what exactly is troubling you, okay, our children.
Mudhe, what is the long-lasting solution to this? Because there's a very interesting perspective being brought in by Mudhoni that we don't see this in other schools like Mangu, Starehe. That doesn't happen.
Some schools have very long traditions of problem solving. And I think that is where all of us in education have always aspired to look at some of these schools as role models for how to structure school management. For instance, Starehe is known for its student barazas, and many of us have gone to Starehe, including public schools, isn't it? Just to see how they run these barazas, these student barazas, as a way of linking management with students. But like Mudhoni is saying, we need not to position this issue as a COVID issue. It is not a COVID issue. This is an issue we've had for very many years, for decades and decades. And I want to take us back to 1987, when one of the very first task forces was set to look at the issues of school fires.
Yeah.
It is not a new problem. And the fact remains, right now, we have looked at, all of us, and this is something that has been triggered over the years by some of the unions, that we need to look at our boarding school structures. We cannot institutionalize so many children when the issues are more to do with quality of education rather than access to education.
Yeah.
There are parts of this country that cannot do without boarding schools, because the distances between schools and the safety of children, like for instance, where we are trying to get more girls into schools, for instance, where we are trying to keep boys away from, you know, the nomadic lifestyle so that they can gain an education, early childhood, you know, early marriages,
yeah,
where we are trying to increase access, yes, we need boarding schools, sometimes even from primary. But on the whole, like Mudhoni is saying, we do have an abnormally high number of boarding schools that are not particularly geared to access to education. They are geared towards, because there are few high quality schools, the number of the perceived high quality schools in Kenya.
Yeah.
And then that has driven another narrative amongst parents that for your child to do well, they need to go to a boarding school.
Yeah.
We need to change that narrative. And already I think with the restructuring of the education system, we have already started that discussion to switch back,
yeah,
and reset our settings about how we view schooling. So that A, we can make it less selective, because that is the core of the problem. The best go into the best schools, yet they come from mixed ability primary schools. You can study from Kibra in that primary school and still get good marks. But somehow we extract you and put you in a foreign environment to keep that growth. We need to invest more in our nearest secondary schools,
yeah,
so that then we can equalize and make access to education just that simpler,
yeah,
so that we can stop having some of these issues.
Okay. Well, you remember, what is the environment like in schools today? Is there a fundamental breakdown in communication that means the administrators can't pick out unrest before it actually boils to the surface? Is there a fundamental breakdown between the school administration and the students?
Thank you. I don't think so, because if we talk about communication between the students and the administration, and even, yeah, the teachers, it could have improved now, because the schools are more democratized. We have been moving through this process of bringing some element of democracy in schools.
Yeah.
And I presided over one of the earliest elections of student prefects way back in 1998 or thereabout, and it has since picked up. So there's an element of some representation of students and how they can. And later on, we were able to even fix in the constitution. No, it was the act. The representation of students in the management of schools. And right now, we are grappling with people who are the ministry and who are thinking they should be removed because we put them as part and parcel of the Board of Governors, in fact. And later on, people were thinking we were extreme. I think we were working with the late minister who came from Ukambani, Kalonzo, Mutula Kilonzo. So I think it may not be real communication.
So what is it?
But the pressure that is in schools is real, and I want to agree with all the speakers on everything they've said. There's a little bit of pressure that is extreme in schools because of the condensed calendar. That pressure is also because that after having gone back to school after COVID, despite the condensed number of weeks for curriculum coverage, which I think is about 30 instead of 39, we still are having the old tenets that ranking kind of is back. You saw when we were taken to the Kenya National Examination Council and schools were being ranked. So the pressure that comes with a performance is still just inside the schools. Some teachers were disciplined by the Teacher Service Commission for having not performed well. That element is still in schools, and people are working too hard, extremely too hard, to perform, not to be punished. We saw some education teacher administrators reprimanded by the communities because of performance. So what am I speaking about? That despite the COVID situation, we are still being judged by the old tenets of performance and everything else that was there. How I wish we could look at that in terms of also just laxing it and make sure that the system is within the mental and the environment of COVID. But in terms of, is this a new thing? No, I think Mudhoni is right. That is 2016, Mudhoni, it's not 2017. And I was here with you. I was to be arrested outside here, but I was lucky I survived. You remember that year, the schools had burned so much and had declared the schools that schools would be closed, just like the heads did. And the then Minister for Education, Matiang'i, was very, very unhappy with me and almost fixed me over that particular thing. I'm happy now it's coming from the heads and they are taking it positively. So we have had the school fires before, and even over intense magnitude, like in 2016. So we cannot look at the fires just in the context of COVID. It is broader than just COVID. I remember that particular time, the schools that burned were over 100. And the ministry was competing with stakeholders on whether to close them or not. Finally, they never closed them. Yesterday, speaking on one of the media houses, at 9, I told them to give after. I'm happy they listened, maybe, or they did not listen, or they had the same idea, and they gave after. After is good because it's a break. Even when a game is being performed and your team is not performing well, you can always call for a timeout. So I think a timeout is good for everybody, so that the students' counseling can involve the parents, involve the community, ourselves, including yourself from Bija, and they can also just have a break before going back. But the risk is that if we go that particular trend for a long time, then the students will take over the management of schools. They'll know that if we want this to happen, we have to ban them.
But even then, if you don't address that, the lying
because
issues.
My other friends are here, we don't need really the boarding schools. Why are students just burning the dormitories? They are not burning classes, they are not burning laboratories. The problem is in the boarding institution. And one of our speakers here was correct to say that in some schools, this is not happening, like Starehe, like Alliance, and so on and so forth. It boils on infrastructure. What is the type of infrastructure we have in schools for boarding vis-a-vis the old established schools? I think that's where the problem is. Students in our boarding schools, like Madam here said, are simply in death traps. They are queuing for food, they are queuing for toilets, they are queuing for water, they are queuing for teachers, they are queuing for classes, they are queuing for desks. Those are issues.
But even this time out that we give, I mean, it's not a lasting solution if we don't address the underlying cause of this unrest.
Just to chip in from where Mheshimiwa has left, one, unrests are unique to circumstances. We cannot say that the causes of unrest in 2016 are the same causes today. The students we had in 2016 and the circumstances were quite different from what we're experiencing today. Perhaps at that time it was because of the mock pressure, and they dealt with the issue. The mocks were not there, and we went back and relaxed a bit. Today, and the idea is COVID is a factor. However much we ran away from it, and the condensed program.
No.
And then they're talking about, they'll have their time to respond. They're talking about boarding schools. You don't have to dim your brother's light for your light to shine even bigger. The solution is not to do away with the boarding schools. Just make day schools attractive. You cannot say that you're going to contain students from going to boarding schools in Alliance and be in Habondi when Alliance is doing better than Habondi. If you do away with boarding schools, you're going to give birth to a bigger generational problem. How will a student from Ebusakami in Bunyore come to Mangu or to Nairobi school, since facilities in such schools as Mangu and Nairobi are not across this country? Let us look at the traditional national schools that have all the facilities, that have all the manpower, that have been doing well. I think this is a scheme by a certain section of Kenyans to exclude bright and intelligent sons of the poor from using or sharing facilities that are in these boarding schools. Let us just make our day schools attractive. And it is wrong to say that this problem is specific to boarding schools. Just because students are burning dormitories, day scholars are doing worse things. Because they don't have a dormitory to burn, they have teachers to burn, they have teachers to beat. A school in Kakamega County called St. Joseph's in Nangalas, yeah, which is purely a day school, is now on strike because they were refused time to watch a football match. And indiscipline cases are even more in day schools, only that they do not have dormitories to burn to get the national attention that the boarding schools are getting. Okay. So the issue of indiscipline cuts across. Okay. It's only the reaction that is different.
All right.
You see, the concern here is not a competition as to what is more grave and what is not. But clearly, we cannot sit here and discuss how learners will be burning their colleagues in the dormitory. We have lost children in those types of jokes.
Yes, we have.
We have lost people. We have buried. We were in Changuli. We buried people there. Said Kizito, Bombolulu. The examples
Moi
can
girls.
Go on. Our
Moi
own
girls.
Moi girls here. So it's not whether or not. The question is, do we really want to continue risking the lives of our children in such kinds of jokes? It is one thing for a day school to go on strike, but what is the risk involved? I think that is a discussion here, and okay. That is why parents are beginning to feel very afraid about leaving. It's not. Nobody is arguing that let us abolish or let us not, but it is the level of risk that people are looking at here. And while we are there, I think the discussion is really so broad. And the questions we should be asking ourselves is, for example, when we had 100 schools going up in flames in 2016, what were the findings? The findings were there is a lot of pressure, even in those boarding schools. When we went to Moi Girls here, we discovered that there are things called triple deckers, one bed, two bed. And so you leave your child in school and they are sleeping on the ceiling. So the type of congestion that was there, you know, that is the pressure that we are speaking about. And when we talk about that kind of pressure, we ask ourselves, is it really worthwhile? Or when the child is comparing the kind of comfort that maybe they could have had, had they not been thrown. In fact, some children have even told their parents they have thrown them in some boarding institutions. And you know, while all this is happening, is because Kenyan's parents do not have choices. You cannot risk taking your child to a day school because it is not at the level of that boarding institution. So the first fundamental mistake that has happened in this country is that the government has not invested to put all schools at the standard. Now that is not a problem that we can solve overnight, but probably we would really encourage government to start now investing in boarding schools so that we do not sit here again 4 years down the line as we did in 2016 with Omboko Milemba here and agonize about the same issues. And while we are at it, I would really want to ask government one question.
Yeah.
Point to us one more school that the government has set up. The government has stopped setting up brand new schools absolutely and completely. And that is a big question, and we must discuss it. The only thing that is happening is adding one more classroom and adding one more. That is not sufficient. Okay. Why I'm complaining about not adding more schools is because, sitting as the CEC for Nairobi, I know that government is sitting pretty, as all public land belonging to schools is being grabbed by everybody. So what will happen in 2030 when we have so many children to take to school and no land left? So I think there is also the lack of seriousness on the part of government, really. And we will sit here and still agonize, blame COVID like we are doing. Then COVID will go and something new will come. Like that time, let's say that there is usually pressure in the schools. And really congratulate the teachers, because the head teachers, they've always taken it upon themselves. They always source money. They're the ones who struggle with the parents to be able to raise money from the schools, because our government is also not doing so well in terms of sending government money to the schools. So the principals struggle so hard. They need support from government to decongest. We need government to start developing new institutions. And the last time we spoke about this, we were told it is the CDF that you now start putting up new schools. Show me where CDF has put up a brand new school. They're adding one classroom, building some kitchen here, building some. That is not the concept. We really need to get serious. Let's see, what population do we want to address? By 2030, how many learners are we going to accommodate with the kind of facilities that we have? And what is the growth that we are looking at? We really need to be very serious with this discussion, okay. Trevor.
All right, Mude, what are your thoughts on this? And also, we were talking about the break that Mwalimu Milemba mentioned. If we don't address the root cause of the unrest, the break will not help, really, because the students will still come back to the same institution that they had grievances with.
My thoughts on this are, being a person in the sector, you know, for us, we had already started advising our schools, because of course, while we operate within a government calendar, we have some leeway, and we had already started telling guys, look, it's looking like that there's a problem. So let us think of a midterm break. And then we sat very quickly, and I think there was a stakeholders engagement, and the midterm was announced. I think right now that number one, we are better off recovering these learning losses than if we had not put in a strategy to recover the learning losses, number one. Keeping students at home longer, we already had major issues, especially with our girls, secondary school girls, with the long closure. As we sit here, there are neighboring countries that have gone 77 weeks with schools closed. And like Mudoni has said, COVID will come and go. I think here, one piece of advice perhaps I can give, and I know this for a fact, when HSA says there is no extracurricular in schools, that is not quite true. What we don't have is the inter-school activities. In the schools, we are running our activities. We can't sit with students in class morning till night. We are doing extracurricular activities, but there is no inter-school activities. And I'm looking forward to the resumption of the calendar in May, because next term is of course third term. In third term, we don't have inter-school activities. But throughout, we've had in-school activities going on. And just like Muloni has somehow alluded, while the problem has started, it has been worse in the past, including 2019. Yeah, it has been worse.
Yeah.
And head teachers, even both public and private, we are getting better. Principals are getting better. School managements are getting better at figuring out how to manage students when issues arise.
Yeah.
The one thing, and I know Mheshimiwa here will come at it, is that sometimes there's a feeling that schools and parents have to bear the burden of this destruction.
Yeah.
And we need to figure out a way to instill the sense of value for public property and private property in our case, because in 2016 we did get caught up in the fires as well. There were private schools that burned.
Yeah.
These kids just walk away scot-free, yet arson is in law illegal. You know, it's a crime. And in 2016, there was the idea that we need to firm up the idea of how kids who move others to destroy public property and private property for that matter, there must be some consequence. We have already started seeing the investigations in some of the fires that have happened. What is going to happen to these children who actually lit fires? What happens when a kid kills another because of that action? Or injures, there are kids who are injured getting away from this fire. What happens to those kids who've been identified as the ones who triggered this? What is the actual consequence? Are they going to walk away scot-free and just move to another school? Usually they move to a private school.
Yeah.
And they cause major indiscipline there. What is the consequence? I think we need to have, as we are sorting the problems, surely we cannot not have consequences to public, destruction of public property and private property.
Okay.
It is something that we are not doing right.
Okay.
Yeah? There are countries that have set very high penalties for destruction of public property. How come we in Kenya are not having that conversation? We must make sure, first and foremost, that society holds these children to account. When schools get burnt, who pays the burden? It is the parents of those who are left, who are not implicated.
Yeah.
They are the ones who have to fundraise for getting back on board, to get the school back going.
Okay.
If we can't keep allowing, in my opinion, very small number of children who perhaps can't articulate themselves in a manner that the schools have prescribed, because yes, we are having issues. Like when I just said, yes, we have indiscipline in our schools, both day schools and boarding. But is that the way to solve the problems and the issues that arise in schools? Light a match on a mattress, which is highly inflammable. Is that surely the way?
Yeah.
We must instill a sense of national, you know, when somebody, a child is in a school, if they don't want to be in that school, surely there's another way rather than burning that school.
Okay.
Yeah? If they are feeling under pressure, surely there's another way to solve that issue.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mwalimu Milemba, as administrators, did you receive the same students you sent home? Because there was an argument that when they went home for 9 months and they came back, they were different people, which points to the failure of parents to discipline their own children.
Oh, certainly we did not receive the same type of students. But I want to make some few statements, then I just come to this.
Okay.
That other reasons why we have a little bit more pressure in schools now could be also the age factor of the students who are in school. You know, we are having an A-level class in school, but we are not prepared for the A-level class. Ordinarily, age goes with classes, okay. And that's the arrangement. But now we have much older students in schools. I think our principals are asking them to look at that. The form fours and form twos, everybody's possibly much older than he was. Another thing is the issue of the school fees tussle between the ministry and the administrators and whether to pay, don't chase away. Well, I will not speak on that a lot, but you know that may also create a pressure point because most of the strikes arise from the dormitories, from the boarding section.
Yeah.
Could we also understand that the boarding section, in terms of policy of government, the government does not believe in boarding. The government's policy is to literally move away from boarding and tuition. If you ask Parliament to give money to schools for boarding and tuitions, they will tell you no. To give money for boarding, they'll tell you no. They'll tell you, let's give money for tuition.
Yeah.
So somewhat within government circles, though not properly legislated, they are moving away from the boarding and from the idea of institutionalizing children to be in school. They started with colleges, and I'm here. I'm an example of a university student who was just in college throughout, but now they're outside. The colleges are now also doing it, and I'm sure that is where it seems we are headed to. Yeah. So the boarding debate, I think we shall bring it on later on. It can come through Parliament as a law. It can come through the ministry as a government-sponsored law. Or just policy, and I think the public participation will be important so that people understand whether we still need the boarding or not.
Yeah.
But above all, if we are able to levelize the quality of education in all the schools, then we shall not need the boarding. What is the history of boarding?
Yeah.
I'm a teacher of history and government. It was to protect the children that Madam has talked about. In fact, the girls, for instance, we may still need them in some areas. And also it was to make the African children go to school. Because originally to take a student to school was difficult. and need to encircle him and have control over him, because there were many interests outside. But that's a topic for another day. I must say that another cause for these problems in school now are drugs. I know I was talking to the teachers yesterday, and they told me to speak for them, not to speak for myself. In fact, they complained that when you go there, you are fairly harmonized. Just say what we are telling you. They say there are drugs in schools.
Yeah.
And they further say that they have no control over how to deal with students because of the liberalized society. Some of them thought of the cane, which I don't believe in. I'm giving you the perspective of the teachers, not mine. They thought that they don't have hands-on, like my brother there said, that a student can just cut a teacher's hand. And I think it's one of my notes, which they wrote to me. Yeah. And then the teacher can do nothing about it. So I also thought that there's need for a policy framework on how to deal with the discipline of students and follow up even those who are involved in these criminal affairs. Having said that, did we receive the same students? We did not receive the same students. They were much older. They had interacted so closely with outside society, and that's why possibly the teachers are talking about the issue of alcoholism and drugs within the schools.
Yeah.
And basically, the students were not, some of them were even pregnant. And we advised our teachers not even to chase them away from schools, but to do GNC. Unfortunately, guiding and counseling is not mainstreamed in our schools. The people doing guidance and counseling are teachers who have just undergone little workshops to do GNC.
Yeah.
So when we go back now to a framework that will help the situation, then we'll be talking about a psychosocial model that will actually help the teachers. I know the private schools have done much better than the public ones.
Yeah.
They even involved their students some sort of psychosocial models that helped them.
Yeah.
But this has to be mainstreamed in our schools within the public sector, so that we have professional counselors in every school.
Yeah. But isn't that a direct indictment on parents? If the students were with them for 9 months and then they come back and they're different people, isn't the parent who fail, right, in disciplining their students?
Whether that will make anybody happy for me to blame the parents or not, the truth is that most of the children have been mentored by teachers. And how many times will a student tell you that my great teacher, so-and-so, Umboko Milemba, if I did a good work, that is, or Oyaya Jerateng, who taught me in all level, did a good job. So parents for a long time have been very positive and comfortable with students being in schools for a longer time. That's a fact.
Okay. Let me bring up some feedback that's coming through here before we take a quick break here on Daybreak. There's a lot of them. Let me try and read half of them if I can. Ojuang Noah says, we cannot discuss student unrest within the Kenyan secondary schools while leaving out teachers. They are equally strained and could be abetting these fires. Let the issue be looked into comprehensively and avoid escapism. Okay.
Yeah.
Sam Masika says, resolve infrastructural issues in the schools, government to ensure they send school money in time. Avoid solving current issues like 1902. Things have changed. Okay. Otiso Rogers says, half-term break started by Ministry of Education would not be a solution to curb unrest in schools. Let the national government, together with the Ministry of Education, look for a lasting solution. Don Makaberi says, some reasons are lack of goodwill to have conversations and reasonable policies that lead to hefty fines, incorrigibility and indiscriminative treatment of different classes in schools, student harassment through forced disciplines like REs and school's choice. Well, we suffered these things. Okay. Valentin says, this break will only send a message to these learners that they have the ability to cause panic to the government. Therefore, they will always cause unrest rampantly so as to be given a break. Let the use of kiboko be introduced one. Okay. People advocating for kibokation there. Elias skips, we all know where the rain started beating us. It is the time the cane was outlawed. This will continue till it is brought back again. Emily Mutwiri says, as a teacher, I welcome the midterm break. Kids are really tired and they need to ventilate. The level of indiscipline is quite high, including sneaking and seeking solace in drugs amidst the backlog. Let's mind the students' welfare. Mogire Jasper says, as usual, we are offering simple solutions to complex issues. It's a whole range of problems from workload, uniforms, the idea of our schools being semi-prisons. Spies won't help an iota, just more representation,
repression
and more strikes. Musioka Let us abolish boarding schools in Kenya. They are the source of most of the antisocial behavior exhibited by our children, e.g. Illuminati, homosexuality, lesbianism, drug and substance abuse, etc. Okay? Dr. Odidi Owiti says, too little too late with these knee-jerk measures. Withdraw the circulars that take away school administrators' authority to discipline the students. All right. On that note, let's take a quick break. There's this issue of discipline. Let's talk about that when we come back. All right? See you in a bit.